Yeah, so tell me in a few words what it's all about. I mean, not what we are talking about.
Right.
Let's leave it to the interview, but to the talk. But
Ari Folman, for instance, we shot a very popular one that has very heavy Israeli viewership. You know, and I think they'd seen the film and they were interested in Ari.
Sure.
And they were, you know.
Yeah.
So
we were in the same class. Me and Ari Folman.
That's funny.
Yeah.
So what school was it?
Tel Aviv University. We studied together.
Is it film school or just regular?
Yeah, it's a university with like you have here USC,
right.
You know, and we have a film department.
So it's a regular university, and you were in the film department.
Yes.
So you were always interested in film. This is not a new thing.
No.
By the way, the interview apparently started.
Okay.
Just so you know.
So okay.
But the so you started the you decided you always wanted to be a film person or.
Well, I think it's a mystery. I mean, how did I? The thing was that I just you know, after the army in Israel, it's kind of a common, especially in my age, that everyone after he served the army for 2 years, they just want to run away from Israel. Most of them find themselves in Australia, in India, you know, in the south of America, and I somehow found myself in Hawaii, right? A long story, you know, lots of coincidence.
Right.
And I, you know, time for me to decide, should I stay here or should I, like my mother want me, to come home and study something. And the truth was that I didn't know what I want to study. So I was, through all my youth, I was into art, writing and, you know, but never into filmmaking. I was not this kind of a guy that, you know, with the camera or whatever. And in the end, I had three choices. The one was mathematics and philosophy. The second was mathematics and cinema. And the third one was philosophy and cinema. And I looked just by the hours, what it fit me. So I studied the philosophy and cinema. And I just fell in love.
Where all the classes are held in a coffee shop somewhere?
Yeah, something like that. Yes.
Good for your schedule?
Yes.
So did you become passionate about it as you were at school? Or?
Yeah. So the first year in cinema, you know, in cinema studies changed my, you know, my views. I really fell in love with that. Yeah, and I decided that's what I want to try and do. And
So is it a more production-oriented school or more criticism-oriented school?
Well, no, there are pragmatical studies, you know. You mean, is it theoretical or what?
There are a number of film schools that are kind of lean more towards film criticism and the idea of film and intellectualism of film.
I see. No. It is famous for this department, but, you know, I managed to be in a first of all, in the, at that time, in the how to say, we call it producer department, but it's not just producer; it's the directors, editor, you know, all the actual. But yes,
I guess
so. It was really a very unique time, and it's considered in Israel. It's considered everybody call it in the film business the year. Why? Because it's in that the same year was I studied with me, you know. Very successful directors. One of them is Ari Folman, as you said, but also others. That and many of them of us made like films that really changed something in the Israeli filmmaking. You know, there's a big change now in the Israeli filmmaking. It's not industry,
right.
But you know, some people make films. You know,
well, it's an interesting thing because I think it happens everywhere. I mean, I know in the United States and Hollywood and all that, there are periods where, you know, a year or two, groups seem to form at USC or in Austin or in Seattle or whatever that end up being significant and going on for decades. And you know, for some reason, there seem to be clusters.
Yes.
Of talent. Maybe it's because they all feed off of each other and it works out that way. I don't know.
Well, it's probably it's a matter of luck because, you know, we are not from the same area, the way we were a very small group, I think only 20 people learned in the class, I mean in the whole, you know, year. So you had to work and to compete,
right.
Especially. So that's really what make you I think, and yes, it's when Ari Folman was nominated to the Oscar, mm-hmm. so they made all those fuss about it, and you know, so they made a big article about this class, and suddenly, mm-hmm. you know, also I realized, you know, you don't think about it during the year.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, it's surprising. Yeah.
So did this story just come upon you? Did you start shooting videotape in the house, in the flat, as you went along and not knowing that it was become something, or how did this actually begin?
Well, if we have the time, and we have now the time,
yes,
have, you know, I made before another full-length documentary film. It's mm-hmm. called The Comediant. It was also released in the States in 2002. Mm-hmm. It was very successful in Israel. Mm-hmm. And it was the first time I made the documentary feature film. And because I was educated and I thought I'm going to make only fiction films. So it was really my first experience. Mm-hmm. And I felt in love with that because it also tells a story, but it has all this research. As in, it's about this other film is about also family and Jewish history. That mm-hmm. this is a family that that made the Yiddish theater, you mm-hmm. know, this Jewish classical, you know, language. And so, but it
in
took
Israel
me,
or in the United States?
No, in the United States. Originally, they were from, you know, what they call the Second Avenue mm-hmm. in the New York. Yeah, and they start. Yeah.
Second Avenue Theater School.
Yeah, one of them is called Mike Burstein. He's a was very big star in Israel, and now mm-hmm. he's living in L.A. off Broadway stuff. You know, mm-hmm. so anyhow, I was making this film for 4 years, and then you know, another 2 years you're running with the film.
Right.
You're getting exhausted, but you want to make. I wanted to make the next film, but I knew that if I'm going to make this film, mm-hmm. I'm going to spend another 4 years. So I became very picky. You know, after you make such films, many people approach you and say, you know, I have a beautiful story for you. Or I have, you know, and I heard amazing stories that each one of them deserve a film, mm-hmm. but not my film. So time passed by, mm-hmm. and I didn't do nothing. Just say no. And you know, now I can say it was kind. Maybe it was even a, what you call a writer blocks. You know, mm-hmm. some kind of a stuck that after you have a success, sometime it happened to you. So
I think the festival circuit does it to a lot of people.
Yeah,
I think
yeah.
when films get on the that festival circuit for a year or two, mm-hmm. that the filmmaker kind of gets in, they're talking about it a lot, and they're like staying in that one film, and yes. they never. It's hard to get out of after
yeah.
that, and it's hard to. If you've gotten a lot of positive attention, it's hard to, you know, also there's pressure to repeat that level of success or that kind of attention or whatever. And I think it really does stop up a lot of filmmakers who've had festival runs.
Yes.
It's a weird thing.
Yes. I agree with you. I think something like that happened to me. And then my grandmother passed away and I had a crazy idea. I'm going to make a very short film mm-hmm. just to make something. And that's mm-hmm. how it happened. I took my camera and start to film in the flat. And mm-hmm. I had an idea, but the idea was really to make something like 20, 25 minutes film, you know, maybe sell it to local TV, mm-hmm. and then I have my connection, my name. And if not, just to have it to the family archive. But the main idea was just to do something, really, just to get out of this situation and to do something that it's not so meaningful. It's for me, you know? And of course, everything changed, and I didn't want to make a film. You know, I worked on this film 5 years mm-hmm. to make the flat. So everything turned upside
worse.
Down. Yeah, it got worse. It got worse, and I'm running already for more than a, let's say, 1.5 year with the film. So it's getting dangerous. I need to stop it. Yes.
So how long was it from the time you started filming in the flat till you suddenly realized something else was going on?
It took time because in the beginning. I was coming, you know, when you're doing such work, or at least in our family, it's not something you are doing in 1 or 2 days.
Right.
You know, my mother came, then she got tired, then this came, then she, you know, this came, you know, it took time. Mm-hmm. And I was running after them. Sometimes they didn't tell me that they are coming, or they didn't mm-hmm. want it. You know, it started like that. And then one day, I met just in the street a friend of mine, a mm-hmm. cinematographer, And we wanted to work for a lot of time together. I knew her from the university, and she's a very talented cinematographer. But she just had she was not young, and she had her first child, and she decided, you know, to film, to be a cinematographer. It's, you know, very tiring job. So she decided to take 1 year off. Mm-hmm. And then this was the time that she decided it's enough. She started to take her kid to the kindergarten or whatever. Mm-hmm. So she met me and she told me, you know, if you want, what are you doing? I told her, she told me, if you want me, I live just here, mm-hmm. but I'm free from 8 to 4. Nobody would take me. But right. if you want, I'm into the, you know, project. And of course, for me, it was a treasure. She's brilliant. So we doubled the team. And we continued like that, something like 2 months. And after 2 months, she looked at me and told me, Arnon, you know, as you know, I must tell you, it's very nice what's going on, but to be honest, it's a film about nothing. Mm-hmm. Nothing happening. There's no story, and I understand your love for your family, etc. And we almost quit it. And I told her, you know, there is this scene in the film that you see me with the boom, because that's what happened. Mm-hmm. She was, you know, with the camera. I was. I told her, you see me. We are like fishermen. Something will happen. And I didn't believe that something would happen. I just hoped. And so, it's. I think not before 2 months of shooting, we suddenly realized that, you know, there are very interesting things in the flat, not just humorous. You know. Ironical scene, so yeah. So from that moment on, it was a whole procedure. You know, it took. There's another story, or not?
No, please.
You know, I may tell, and you know, it's kind of. So, one day, there is in Israel. They call it pitch conference. It's for documentaries. They give you like 7 minutes to pitch your project. You know, it's very, you know, you find it all over the world. Yeah. This is how people don't like to read script anymore. And anyhow, everybody knows what's written in the script, especially in the documentary. You never find it in the film.
Right.
So there is this pitch conference, and the organizer, the director of this conference in Israel, she heard that I'm making a film. And she liked my previous film a lot, and she told me, you must come and pitch. You know, you have like 7 minutes, you need to, I don't know, 4 minutes or 5 minutes speak about the film, 2 minutes to show some excerpt, and hope that some TV station or foundation will grab your film.
Right.
So I told her, thank you very much, I'm sure come, but next year, because I have nothing. It's only the beginning, I'm not sure there is a film here. And she convinced me, she told me, no. So I went on stage and I pitched, of course, completely another film. Mm-hmm. You understand that? I had, and on stage, there were like 20 people from, you know, all over, also from America, but mainly from Europe, because Israel is more, you know, close. On stage, the most important man from this group, he was a chief editor in the Arte TV station. This is the cultural TV, very big stage TV station in Germany and France. Mm-hmm. And that is a big investor in filmmaking and documentaries mainly, but also not just documentaries. Mm-hmm. So he on stage, he told me, or not told everyone, I want this project. And I was shocked. It was, you know, a really frightening moment because I knew I had nothing. So, first of all, two things happened. In the end, we signed a contract with him, but it took us two years to sign the contract with the man that said on stage, I want this project. But the next morning, the three foundations from Israel called me. They won there. So this is how I raised the first money. You know,
but you still didn't have a film. You still don't have any idea what your film was going to be.
No, I have. Of course, I had ideas, but they were different from. And I wasn't believe it's a film. I thought maybe I need to say something.
But it sounds like the ennui and charm of grandma's house and going through.
The idea was the idea. I tell you what was the idea. The idea was that I had a line. Of course, the idea was what can you tell about people from the stuff they left behind? Like, and I wanted to make like, I don't know, 25 minutes film, right. You know, something very visualized and, you know, something like that. So to continue this story, after, let's say, 3.5 years from that moment, or 3 years, there was the time I had to show this, his name is Hans Robert Eisenau, he's very well known in Europe, show him the rough cut, the mm-hmm. first rough cut. And I was arguing with my editor, she's a brilliant woman and very experienced editor, should I tell him before he see the screening that he's going to see another film, you know? Mm-hmm. And she said, no, don't tell
him. Oh, once you had this film?
Yeah, because okay. already, you know, 3 years after right. we signed the contract, and of course I had to send him some script and, you right. know, all this. He knew, but it's not in the contact, you know, he's in Germany right. and he was very friendly and very supportive, but he's not really, you know, yeah. going with you all the way. So he bought one film mm-hmm. and then he got a feature film. The first screening was 2.5 hours. So anyhow, I decided I must tell him, you know, to be mm-hmm. honest with him and prepare him. And I told him that, and he watched the screening, the rough cut. He liked it very much. And he said, of course, he has his comments, very good comments. Mm-hmm. And he said nothing about the fact that it's another film. So I decided, you know, and we... And the session stopped, and we went, you know, you go to eat lunch with him right. and chat, you know, about life, about cinema. And I decided to ask him. I said, okay, you like it now. Now I'm free, I must ask you. And he told me something very interesting. He told me, you know, it's not another film. So mm-hmm. I said, how can it be? You cannot know, you know, you couldn't know a thing that I didn't know.
Right.
So he told me, well, listen, I bought a film about generation gaps. I bought a film about what can you learn about people from the stuff they left behind. Mm-hmm. I bought a film about the flat that Germans living in Tel Aviv in some kind of an exile. Mm-hmm. And this is, for me, this is the film. And it was very interesting, very, you know, but of course he had to gamble, you know, because, yeah. So.
Well, it might have been a different good film had this all not come up, but.
Yeah, maybe.
It wasn't. It's a yes. different movie.
Yes. So,
I mean, but I think he's also actually completely right. I think it is all those things. Your log line still fits.
Yes.
You know, except it becomes part of a murder mystery.
Yes.
So at the point where you had to put on your Sherlock Holmes hat, is that something you were enthused about immediately? Was it something you really wanted to do? Was it fun that to run into this? I mean, obviously, it's also stressful, but was that a pleasure to have something else to do?
Well, I think it was. It became like an obsession because I really were enthusiastic, you know, and I found so many, you know, at the beginning, I was researching many other stories. You know, I found mm-hmm. evidence for many other stories, which were all, I didn't know so many things about my grandparents, mm-hmm. which in the end didn't find a way it was not interesting enough for the public, let's say. But
right. But
for me, as a family member, I was amazed. And, you know, all kind of amazing stuff. I found, for example, letters mm-hmm. from a guy named Ernst Freud. He's the son of Sigmund Freud. Hmm. So it's amazed you know, what happened? How right. did they become in contact? What does it mean, you know? So
sounds like a sequel.
Yeah, yes. So I was really became obsessive about it, and there was a problem because everything, or like 99%, was in German, and mm-hmm. I cannot read German. So I really had to, you know, find, and I had no money, you know, mm-hmm. to send it to translating, or so I had to find my way to, you know, some people to translate me and some money to invest. And
right.
But I had to somehow understand what to translate. So it was really kind of, as you said, the detective job. And I think it was the most fast. I think that in documentaries, the research is the most fascinating time because mm-hmm. you're free, you feel your thought, you can make it that way as many films you want in right. your mind, and you learn and you meet stories you never, you are entering, it's like a film, you know, you're entering a world mm-hmm. you never knew before, and it's exciting. I like it, and now it's about people I know, so.
It is interesting that documentarians, I mean, there's some who kind of know what the answer is before they shoot anything, and but in this case, it's kind of like you were shooting and actually it was almost like a cinema verite. At the same time, it was also meant to be something more, you know, kind of poetic, I guess, yes. originally. It yes. turned from one kind of film into another.
Yeah, it was. It really was. And
you turned from Ken Burns into Errol Morris.
Yeah, you know, I think that, you know, during this, I will tell you another anecdote. You know, during the time when you are shooting and you're all the time trying to restructure what you have to tell a story. That's me, because I that's my interest, let's say, to tell a story, yes? Mm-hmm. And but, you know, it's take time to understand. You know, this is every filmmaker has this, you know, this is our job. So in one point, I really was in crisis, because I didn't know how to tell the story. Of course, every time I shoot and found out other things, you know, but everything changed. But during the time, in order to get money, especially from foundation, this film received, I think it's the first Israeli documentary that got the foundation support of the German Film Foundation. Hmm. Became a film because of that, 35 millimeter film, and it was being screened the fifth month over Germany in the German cinema. Hmm. So you must all the time make scripts. Of course, it's some kind of contradiction.
Right.
But anyhow, I heard of someone from England that he came to pitch, and he considered himself like the McKee, mm-hmm. you know, story of the commentaries. And somebody told me about him and said, you must go and hear him, mm-hmm. and he'll solve you the story, you know, he'll tell you how to tell it. And I entered this seminar, mm-hmm. of course I ran, you know, why not? This illusion that someone will tell you how to do it, you know, you always think in the end it's a big disappointment, because nobody can solve your stories. You need to find the solution in yourself. There's no. But anyhow, why I'm telling you that, this guy, I don't remember his name, but he was a producer or something of The Naked Chef, of Oliver.
Jamie Oliver.
And he, the first sentence, the second sentence that he said, he told us how he structured a film. And the first sentence was, I know where I go, I know what will be the result, and now I'll show you how to go to right. reach it. And I took my little bag and went out of the class. I knew it. I came to the wrong place, mm-hmm. because for me, it's the opposite. For me, if I knew before where I'm going, it's dead. It's not for me, you know. The whole fun you lose, you know. So,
well,
you're right.
If it makes you feel any better, I want to throttle Robert McKee every time I am yes. anywhere near him. I just want to go over and start choking him immediately. I think he's done a great disservice to film screenwriters everywhere. It's a nightmare to me. Ironically, when we talk about how bad of Hollywood cinema has gotten, though, we can have an argument about that. A lot of it is that idea of McKee, is that there is an answer. And I think we find out over and over again every week as the movies come out that there is no answer. There's only filmmakers who are good and filmmakers who are bad, and I think people get lucky and people get unlucky. And, you know,
I think McKee, it's good to have tools. It's
yes.
good to have tools. And he's analyzing, of course, I read his book, you know, like any filmmaker in the world, I think, but. Mm-hmm. You need to be suspicious, you know. Yeah. I think as a filmmaker, you must be, of course, full of faith, but also a bit suspicious, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that this film really was a big lesson for me in that way, because you know, it's a film about German Jews, you know, our family, what we call Yekes, the mm-hmm. German Jews, and one of the special character of those, and it's not a joke, it's a joke, it became a joke, but it's true, that those people are very planned, and they, we like to know things in advance, and to organize. And I must tell you, I have this part in myself, and I always, you always want to know how to solve it, and how, and suddenly you go, I'll give you an example. There is a scene in the film where I show my mother a letter, which says something very hard about her grandmother. And I told my cinematographer, listen, because we developed a system, we shoot only with one camera, and how to do it, how to move the camera. We had the idea to shoot me and my mother scene on a tripod, and you know, we had our thought, never mind. But I told her, you don't move from my mother tear, my mother face, because she got a tear. And we did it, and nothing happened. No tear, no nothing. We didn't believe. We went home, and we say, we lost it. What we did wrong? And only after that we understood, no, what, you know, this is the reality. This is the strength of the scene. This is the scene, you understand? And what you your preconcept is, I don't know.
Yeah.
The reality is stronger than it. And I think it happened to me a lot of time during the making of this film. I wanted the, so there was a time that I was, it took me time to understand that this is it. This is the essence to be able to open yourself to grab those things you don't accept to grab. And over there is the true moment, or the true, you know, ticks, or the true, you know, it's over there. And it was a big lesson for me, this film.
Well, your mother and the granddaughter on the other side of this,
yes,
both of them are restrained, and both of them are, you know, trying to figure it out in their own head without showing much of anything.
Yes.
They're really not showing their cards. And that's, I think, the most emotionally most powerful part of the film. I mean, your journey in it is, as somebody says, you know, why does the third generation always the one that's asking the questions? And they're not, they're the second generation, and they don't really, you know, spend all this life not asking the questions.
Yes.
And it's very, that's, I think, where the real power, emotional power of the film is.
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, after I finished the film, I was, you know, when you are making a film so for such a long time, you really are not objective, and you cannot really understand its effect on the others, and of course not on yourself. You have no, you know. It's, but nowadays, when you in Israel, I'm not so familiar with the situation in American TV, but I kind of suspect it's the same. But in Israel, when you switch the channels, you know, for 1 minute, there's no chance you won't find somebody that is crying on screen and telling a really, really hard stories and telling you everything and is crying and, you know. And you see here a film, a feature film, more than 1.5 hours, nobody's crying, no tear. But they hold such a drama inside themselves. And I think this is the power of those, this character, because you feel it. You don't think about it, but you feel the subtext. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's almost, I was thinking fairly early in the film that it's, I made a bad, unfortunate joke about a an Armenian Holocaust movie that was done a few years ago by a filmmaker in Canada that, you know, there's never been one before. It was really the first one covering this. I was like, okay, well, when they
Atom Agoyan.
Atom Agoyan's film, yes, which I'm not a big fan of, but I was like, when they do, then their 10th one, they'll get good at it. Like, we've gotten good at it. Okay. Jews have gotten good at making Holocaust films. So we figured it out. And I think that that's the thing, is this is the Holocaust film that nobody, you know, this is one of those pieces of the puzzle that nobody's really done before. You know, we've had the sweeping, we've had everything from Shoah to the, you know, bodies going into the pit. And this is, you know, human in a different way, but is every bit as real and significant, I think, as the rest of it.
Yeah. I think that Michael Moore, in the film was screened in Tribeca, and he told me afterwards that when he read, he was in the jury, and he, when he read the, what's the film about, he didn't want to see it. He told me, oh no, not again a film about the Holocaust, you know. And I'll tell you something. I also, myself, I didn't believe I will make ever a film about the Holocaust because of the same reason. Mm-hmm. Because of the same reason, because I said, what can I tell? I have no story. What can I say that nobody before told? It's, mm-hmm. you know, I didn't want to at all to touch the it would sound ridiculous now, but it's really reflect also, you know, during all my life, till the film, I was, if you will ask me, why don't you make a film about the Holocaust? I would say, because, you know, the cinema. After that film, I realized that this was only an excuse, because through all my life, that was maybe the biggest finding of me during the last 5 years. All my life, I came from a German Jewish family. Everybody knows what happened. We knew that my family had to leave, you know, Germany. It was all known. Mm-hmm. We had no idea that we have any connection to the Holocaust. We lived. I mean, mm-hmm. when you look at today, it's complete. That show you the power of denial. And it's not because we are not intelligent. You know, right. You don't need to be. You know, every kid mm-hmm. know that in Israel. But, and this is why I think that I used to try to escape from this subject. Mm-hmm. So, as I said, I told myself because of cinematic reason, but not. Now I understand because there was some unconscious thought, you know, mm-hmm. go away, it's danger. And I think that's what really, you know, also because of how I did it and because of who am I mean, not just personally, but the what you call the third generation, you know. For example, there is a very, very big institution in Israel that called Yad Vashem. He's very well known in the mm-hmm. world. He's like the, you know, place for... And I was very afraid by the reaction. Somehow it's sentimental. It's they have no... Mm-hmm. It's not important for filmmaking, you know. Mm-hmm. Of the film, because it shows things not in black and white. It talks about relations between people that I didn't think those people in Yad Vashem, this mm-hmm. very orthodox place, would like to hear about it. And they fell in love with the film. And they came to me and they told me, these are the films we are looking. And then from then on made seminars about it, and mm-hmm. you know, because they say, enough from the other film. And this orthodox, you know, institution, it's enough. Those testimonials, this is really reflect now, what happened now. This is the true now. And I found it very interesting that also they understood it's something, it's true. You know, it's something, it's not just fresh, but it's true.
No, I think that's, for me, that's I think why Shoah is still the best Holocaust documentary without any footage of the Holocaust.
Yes.
Because it's people. Yes. And it's people you can relate to and understand that people, you know, even the people who are evil, quote unquote, in the movie.
Yes.
You see human beings who thought they were doing something that, you know, or rationalized it and all those things. And that's really ultimately the story over and over and over through all of our histories. It's not just the Holocaust, the Jewish Holocaust. It's not just slavery. It's not just killing the Indians in this country. It's we keep on going back to these things. It's kind of stunning. I'm actually, it makes me, that comment about the third generation makes me curious to see 20 years from now what the films about Palestine, the Palestinian situation will be.
Yes.
As, you know, a whole generation of younger, more open-minded, less stuck to the creation of Israel, people in Israel come through and start really thinking about the position the country's taken, for better or for worse, you know.
You mean about the films from the Israeli side or from the Palestinian side?
I think from Israel, well, perhaps from the Palestinian side as well, but I mean, I think Israeli, the 20-year-olds now in Israel who are coming up will have a very different perspective on what the situation currently and in the future means compared to the people who kissed the ground at, when they got off the plane or they got to Palestine for the first time.
No, but we have, I think right now we have a lot of very good films about the situation done by Israelis and lately joint venture between Israelis and Palestinian mm-hmm. directors that are quite, quite open. I mean, not. Yes. I'm not sure how much you're aware of those films, but there are many films that deal with the conflicts, not in the I would say, not the way the government wants you to,
right.
to and which is, of course, a necessity in this place.
Well, Gatekeepers, which is, was just been go traveling around, is stunning, an amazing yes. movie mm-hmm. from Drawer, who's a, yes. you know, your age, I would guess.
Yes.
But also, I think that, you know, a lot of the films about the Palestinian situation has been a lot of, you know, oh, let's do it for the kids. Oh, it's, you know, kids from one side and kids from the other, all still very sweet, yeah. a little treacly,
yes.
not as earnest, and, you know, and doesn't reflect a generation's what happens after a generation, you know,
yes.
what happens
yes.
after time.
Yes.
Because when you have some that kind of perspective, then you can, you know, it changes. It doesn't become as personal or as an instant reaction to things, I think.
Yes.
But yeah, Drawer's film is breathtaking.
I didn't see it yet, but I would.
What's the content, you know, in that case? I mean, the filmmaking is lovely, but it's really, he got, you know.
I know. I know him very well. Yeah, he was a cinematographer in my diploma movie. He studied just 1 year below me, and I know him very well. Yeah. And I'm for sure going to see his film. I'm sure it's good.
The Israeli documentarians all seem to be very nice.
Pardon?
The Israeli documentarians all seem to be very nice. It's an interesting thing.
It's a very, you know, ongoing, the scene is boiling, you know. There was a very good, many good documentaries,
yeah.
and more and better.